Parkinsonia aquileata again spreading in some areas of the dry zone. Penicetum clandestinum is another interesting story. Some of you may remember that Horton plains were cultivated with potato in the mid-70s, and it went up to the late 70s, and due to pressure from the environmentalists, the government abandoned potato cultivation in the Horton plains. One of the first battles won by environmentalists, and actually the potato was cultivated by the Department of Agriculture, and they abandoned the cultivation. And what happened was, after after abandoning the cultivation in the Horton plains, those areas which were cultivated with potato never went back to the original state, and those modified substrate was occupied by grasses that came from the nearby Ambevela farm. And one of the grasses which came is this Penicetum clandestinum, which was an exotic fodder grass, an African fodder grass, which is a very nutritious grass. And the form is almost like a lawn grass form, a prostrate, procumbent habit. And it's a nutritious grass. And the sambar was very happy because they have a nutritious fodder. And then they were protected from the leopards, because they can see approaching leopards very easily. If they were in the natural tussock grasslands, they can't see the incoming leopards, because tussock grasses come up to this high. So the sambar population went up. So that's an indirect impact of this invasive grass species. And when the sambar population went up, again, a lot of things happened. When the grasses became drier and not palatable, they went to the forest and started eating the tree bark. And some of the trees were dying because of that. So there are a lot of complications. And now, of course, now, as that guy in the Jurassic Park says, nature will find a way. And the native grassland species, the tussock grasses, are gradually invading the modified grasslands occupied by this Penicetum clandestine. So you can see here and there tussock grasses coming into this modified grassland. And then when the tussock grasses come, what will happen? Again, the sambar will be in danger, because I saw in my own eyes a leopard approaching a herd of sambar taking cover, you know, behind those bushes. So gradually the sambar that were coming towards the road were kept away, and they didn't come. And when I went there last, I saw the Department of Wildlife people were uprooting those incoming native grasslands, I mean grass tussocks. And I asked, why are you doing this? Because they were uprooting Ulex europaeus, that's okay. But then they were also uprooting the native grasses. So I asked them, why do you uproot them? And they said that certain big person told to remove those, because if those grasses are there, sambar won't come to attract visitors. Now they are going. So this is the country, you know, we live in. Anyway. So Mycenia callosens is another plant introduced by the botanicians. We see it in the same area. You find Clusia rosea, Galgurica, in Nawalapiti, Horton, Hatton, Knuckle, Hatton, Horton, Hatton, Nawalapiti, Ginnikarthaye, Muskelly area. Hortenanthera phylloxerodes. This is a plant introduced to Sri Lanka by our relations in Australia. So they found it as a edible plant in Australia, and they brought it to Sri Lanka and introduced them into their relations and said, look, there's a nice mukunuvanna, let's eat them. So Department of Agriculture even had a trial plot on this, but soon they you know, removed it. So this is another invasive plant. Even in Australia it's considered as an invasive plant. Penicetum polystachyon is another interesting story, because this was first introduced, first reported in 1960s in Malsiripur area. And then in the 70s, this was one of the most serious invasive plants. This guinea grass, Panicum maximum, was only second to this one. But now, Penicillium polystachyon is on the way out. Panicum maximum is coming up. So there are various changes that are happening. Naturally, they are getting their population reduced. It's very interesting thing to note, because that is something we observed in the 70s, it was very common, now it's going down. Tithonia diversifolia, again introduced by the gardens in 1851, is found in upcountry, Madamahanuvara, Kabaragala, Ramboda and various places. It's a green manure also. Started to distribute, the original sightings were mostly along the railway track, and then it went into the interior. Ageratina riparia, again introduced by Botanic Gardens in 1905. Now it's found in various places, not only in Noorelli district, in Haggala, in Ramboda, in Knuckles area also you find this. Aristia clonii is similar, again you find in Noorelli district, Horton Plains. Very, very serious invasive plant. Gasnethicumba, Colocasia, and Milintonia. These are actually kind of potential invasive plants. It's in Buttala, Lunugambahir area. Manihot glaciovi, which was also introduced by the gardens as for rubber. For the Botanic Gardens tried various plants for rubber. Only this para rubber, or Hevea brasiliensis, took off. The others were not that economical or not successful. There were Castilla rubber, this is Sierra rubber, and then Assam rubber. So there are so many species of rubber that were tried by the Botanic Gardens. So, but this was not successful. But then now you find it as an invasive in some mountain areas. Cedium littorale, or China pera, it's also becoming an invasive now in some parts of the mountain area, in Nallathan area and some mountain areas. This is a very recent introduction in the aquarium trade. You see this plant and you find it in some aquatic areas. This is a recent introduction again. This is also found in some aquatic habitats in the western forest. This plant, Mantingia calabura, or jam tree or whatever, it's again introduced by the Botanic Gardens in 1919. Now it's becoming invasive in Moragahakand area, in Waga area, in Tanakumbur area. You see, it's a recent phenomenon. All this time it was a very kind of harmless plant in home gardens. Now it's becoming a serious problem, because there are some certain things which happen due to various changes in the environment, maybe climate, who knows. And another recent introduction, Valentine plant, or star fireworks plant or something. And no, these actually not a scene from here. These seen in the Pacific Islands. You can see a lady here. You can see how this plant covers the entire area in the Pacific Islands. And this lady is virtually masked by the plants. And there is this new invasive plant, which was reported in 2002. At the time I was in the gardens, and then Minister of Agriculture phoned me and said that there is a new grass spreading in his electorate, and he wanted me to see whether it's a native plant or whether it's an exotic plant. So I went to Hanguranketa, and you know who he is, and collected a few specimens, and then found that it was not found in the herbarium, and we sent it to the herbarium at Kew, Royal Botanic Gardens Kew, and they identified it and sent it to us with the name Panicum trichocladum, an East African grass. Even in the Kew herbarium, this was the second specimen. The original specimen was from East Africa and the second one was from us. So it's again spreading, and we found it spreading in various areas, except in the Noorelli area and also in the very dry areas in the lower country, which dry zone. Now we can even see it's taking over areas occupied by guinea grass, Panicum maximum. So it's actually, in a way, removing Panicum from the environment. But then there is another area of research or area of environmental action called assisted migration. Now we know some plants are disturbed or affected by different things happening in the environment. When something happens, we always try to find someone or something to pass the blame on. Now in this country, of course, there was a time when you think something bad happens, we always say that it's due to open economy. And now, of course, it's due to certain person. And then, of course, in the environmental scene, it's the climate change. So, when the populations are, you know, faced with problems, one thing you can do is to plant those species in some other places to prevent from prevent them from extinction. You know, that's called assisted migration. You deliberately move plants from one place to the other so that it will be safe in that new habitat. So they will adapt to these new habitats. And of course, the botanic gardens can play a leading role in that, because botanic that's their prime function, you know, to work on ex situ collections, and they can provide experience on these species requirements, and they can collect and disseminate information about the criteria and best practices, and give expert advice concerning the ecological requirements of those species, and provide plant material and develop seed and ex situ collections to support the study, and offer testing grounds and all these things. So the botanic gardens can come in a big way to help this assisted migration, so that populations will be saved from extinction. So you can select suitable places to conserve those plants that are in danger. So we started that actually in this country a few years back. And this one place, it was mentioned that and you will be visiting that place in August, the Ilukovita Sitavaka Botanic Garden, 105 acre garden, and as large, I mean, a big enough space to conserve some of the species, and it's a beautiful place also. And there's enough space to conserve plants, well laid out, roads and all that. There's ample space to have populations of plants. Now, in ex situ conservation, earlier the practice was to select one or two plants and plant them in an arboretum. If you go to Peradeniya Gardens arboretum, there are about 1,000 odd species, and of course we have one or two individuals from each species. But then by having just one or two individuals, you can't capture the entire genetic diversity. You have to have populations. So that's why you need large areas for these kind of ex situ collections. Sitavaka has some, and also in these Hambantota Mirijala Botanic Gardens, larger area, 300 acre botanic garden, and that also is, I mean, there's enough space. This is actually all planted. This planting started in 2008, and we have a nice collection of trees about this size, trunk. And I mean, they are beautiful areas also, same, and also arboretum with various plants from the dry zone. And also to attract people, we have some ornamental places as well.